in the Lord's house. If you love the Lord, say amen. Amen. Welcome, welcome. It's good to be back, isn't it? It's good to be back. And as many of you knew last week, we did not have a service, any services in the sanctuary last week. We will not have one in the sanctuary tonight either. But we are anticipating, good Lord willing, the opportunity to get back starting next Sunday. We're hoping, and we'll let you know about this coming Wednesday night, but we're hoping that next Sunday we can start back at full steam ahead with all of our services. And we're going to begin on the 24th. The adult Sunday school class will be back in here at 10 o'clock. It needs to end at 10:45. And so if you normally come to Sunday school, we invite you to come out. We've got great Sunday school teachers. We'll be right back here. And then Sunday morning worship service in the sanctuary, and also the Sunday PM. So as you know, as we navigate through all this COVID stuff, we're going to try again, and we're going to keep right on trying, and we're going to continue to pray for all of those that have been affected by COVID. And so that's basically what we're trying to do. Prayer tomorrow night at 7 o'clock. Everyone is encouraged to participate, whether you come out or be in the sanctuary or do it at home. We're looking for you to help us pray at 7 o'clock. We're not going to start any children's church until the first Sunday in February, and so we're looking forward to that, getting that started back again. And the only reason, again, we're not again is to limit the number of times we come together and our children, so forth and so on. So everybody knows, we know the drill by now. How many of you are like me? You're tired of all of this. Anybody tired of it? Me too, amen. We're tired of it. But we got to do the best we can. We want to encourage everybody to social distance. Wear a mask if you want to, obviously. Wash your hands. No handshaking, hugging, that kind of stuff. Continue to use the common sense that we all, the good Lord, give all of us. Amen. Today is Sanctity of Human Life Sunday. We're celebrating that throughout America today. We are not actually going to commit this service to that celebration today. We've got it planned for another Sunday where we'll have somebody come from the pregnancy center here and share a little bit before I preach and so forth. But today is Sanctity of Human Life. We want to recognize that today. And we use this day to recognize that human beings are created in the image of God and that all human life is sacred, set apart for worship and of service to Him. This is to commemorate that many lives lost to and impacted by abortion and commit themselves to upholding the sanctity of human life at every stage. So I want to say that there are what killed more people in the world this year, last year in 2020, was not COVID, it was abortion. And so we've got to stand up, and we will. We'll take a service in very near future to do this. I didn't want to do it the first Sunday we were back, and I've got a speaker lined up. The director hopefully will be here from the pregnancy center to share with us what is going on that front. So anyway, it's great to be back in the Lord's house. January Women's Ministry newsletter is available. Make sure you get one at the main sanctuary entrance. And I believe that's all we have. And I don't know about you, but I sure miss coming to church. I miss all of that. Let's get in here and let's worship the Lord this morning and let the Lord have his way. Everybody say amen. Amen. Sister Jennifer.
Praise God. Has God been good to you? Yes. Hallelujah. He is worthy. I don't care if you're watching online. We welcome you to the house of God virtually. We welcome you here live. But by all means, he's more than worthy of all of our praise this morning. And that's what we want to do. Join together with our brothers and sisters live, online, and let them online even feel the Spirit of God in this place. Hallelujah. We're going to lift up our prayer requests. Geneve Branch has suffered a stroke and needs our prayers. Also, remember the Daniels family at the loss of their loved one, Bumper Daniels. Let's remember that family. Also pray for Sister Shirley Smith. She lost her son yesterday, and his name was Jeremy. And we all know there's more that could be on this list right now. Those that are under COVID's attack and that they're going to be victorious through. Those that are suffering other diagnoses that we've learned of. But the power and the blood and the name of Jesus is over every sickness and over every disease and over every affliction, and already knows our need and has already supplied the answer. So we're going to go to the Lord in prayer, trusting and believing that we're going to see these results and the glory of God revealed. Are there others you'd like to just raise your hand to represent this morning, to join with these? Praise God. Hallelujah. We welcome the Holy Spirit in this place this morning. Hallelujah, Father. We thank you, Lord. And we're going to go to prayer now in Jesus' name.
And we just lift our hands and begin to worship him this morning. Father, we welcome you this morning, God, in this place, Lord. Welcome, Holy Spirit, to do your work, Lord. And Father, we offer ourselves this morning as living sacrifices. The Word of God declares holy and acceptable unto you, God, which is our reasonable service, Lord. We say, Holy Spirit, come. Holy Ghost, have your way. Move, Lord, in this sanctuary this day. Father, that your power and your glory would be manifested in our midst today. Father, we bring every need before you, Lord God. Every prayer request, God, what a privilege it is to take our burdens to the Lord and leave them there, Lord God. We do. We lift up every name, Lord, every person, every family, every situation, God. Lord, that was on that list of those hands that raised, Lord God, they always signify to you, God, that we need you to move. We need you to intervene. We need you to show up, God, Lord, on our behalf. Lord, we pray for our nation that's in chaos. We pray for our leaders, God, this morning. We pray for our churches, Lord God. Oh, let the people of God stand up and declare the goodness of the Lord God. We've come to magnify, to praise you today, to lift you up, Lord, to glorify you. Lord, we pray, God, that you anoint the singing, the preaching, the times around these altars, Lord God. And Father, when we leave here today, we can truly say, it's good to be in your house. Would you just tell the Lord to have your way this morning, Lord? God, have your way this morning, God. Oh, we bless your name this morning. Come on, let's worship the Lord with the praise team this morning.
Amen. How many of you know today that you can trust in the Lord? Amen. We're going to hold to his unchanging hand. Help us as we sing about it today. Amen.
Thank you.
Worship with us as we sing. This song is Raise a Hallelujah. We've done it before. You know, more than ever, as you're going through what we're going through today, it's an opportunity for us to push it all aside, worship the Lord together, and raise a hallelujah to the King. Worship this morning.
Yeah.
tomorrow, and he will see us through. He's faithful today. Let your praises ring up to glory this morning. Sing with us, hallelujah. Give him praise. I raise a hallelujah. Come on, stand and sing today.
I raise a hallelujah. I raise a hallelujah.
He's worthy, hallelujah.
I raise a hallelujah.
Yes.
I raise a hallelujah.
I
raise a
church. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Come on, let's roar, give him praise in the house this morning. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Oh, we bless you, Lord. Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah, hallelujah. I've just come to worship you, Lord, this morning. You know, church, I was just sitting there thinking, as not being able to be in church last week and all these services that we're having to cancel and do different things to try to navigate through what season we're in. And that just makes it that much important that every time we get a chance to come together, we really ought to worship him, amen. Give him the glory and the honor, do his name. Praise the Lord. Would you mind one more time just lifting our hands to the Lord? He said, I'll lift up holy hands in the sanctuary. Lord, just let my offering of praise and worship and adoration, let it just ascend to the throne room of God today, Lord. Let our praise be acceptable. Our worship, Lord, be as a sweet-smelling savor. Let it be well-pleasing unto you that your people have come here to worship you, Lord. Oh, when I think of the goodness and all that is done for me, church, when I think of his mercy, his grace, his loving kindness, for his delivering power. When I think of the blood of Jesus, the cross of Calvary, all the power of the Spirit today. I've got so much to thank him for this morning. Oh, we bless you, Lord. Would you just a moment with the words of your mouth begin to bless him this morning in his house? Lord, we bless you, Lord, this morning. We worship you. We bless you this morning. Oh, welcome, Holy Spirit, this morning. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Amen and amen. We're going to continue to worship this morning in the giving of the tithe and the offering. These buckets are out front. Just come to the one closest to you as the musicians render a selection. God bless you as you continue to worship and give in this morning.
Exalt thee,
exalt you, Lord.
Oh, I exalt thee.
Oh,
I exalt thee.
Oh,
I exalt thee. Oh, Lord.
Hallelujah.
At this time, amen. Give the Lord praise. Yes, amen. This time, worship with Sister Haley as she sings and ministers in music this morning.
Sister Elizabeth's going to help me too, so.
Amen.
Thank her for that. We're going to sing Power of the Cross this morning, and we haven't sung it in a long time. We actually only sang it once, I think, but it's a really powerful song with a really good message. And last night in the car, Timothy and I were talking about the prodigal son and how, you know, he didn't come home because he had changed his mind. And he's like, you know what? My father was right. I think I'm going to go home now. He came home because he was broke and dirty and tired and hungry and thirsty. And then his father is the one who clothed him and fed him and cleaned him up. And that's the power of the cross for us.
Yes.
And I really love that in verse 3. You're going to hear about the prodigal son in verse 3. So just worship with us, and I hope it ministers to you this morning.
A sinner, now a saint. Once bound, now free. That's the power of the cross. See the change.
The chains fall. stand this morning, if you will. I want you to sing this chorus with us. You know, that's a precious song that they just sang. If you know the power of the cross, you remember the moment the chains fell away and you felt the forgiveness of the Father. He deserves all of our praise today. So let's worship together. Hallelujah.
Fill this place with the grace.
Standing as we read the word of the Lord this morning. Praise the Lord this morning. Deuteronomy chapter 31. It's good to be back in the Lord's house. I'm going to share and then we're going to let you be seated as I read. After I read the word of the Lord, I appreciate our praise team and singers and musicians and leading us into the presence of God. I hope that you can feel His presence. And I can tell you something, right? We know we can't always go on feelings, but if you can't feel Him, I just want to let you know He's here. He's here to touch. He's here to minister, to bless, and to help us. And I just thank God for His presence this morning. The word of the Lord reads, "Be strong and of good courage. Fear not or be afraid of them. For the Lord thy God, He it is that doth go with thee. He will not fail thee, nor forsake thee." And Moses called unto Joshua and said unto him in the sight of all of Israel, "Be strong and of good courage, for thou must go with this people unto the land which the Lord hath sworn unto their fathers to give them, and thou shalt cause them to inherit it." Verse 8, "And the Lord said, He it is that doth go before thee. He will be with thee. He will not fail thee, neither forsake thee. Fear not, neither be dismayed. Bow your heads. Father, we humble ourselves. I humble myself, Lord, in your sight this morning. Father, as I often pray, God, help me this morning. Hide me behind the work of the cross of Calvary. Let the Holy Ghost have full use of my faculties this morning. Let me speak as an oracle of God. Let me be unctioned by your Spirit to declare the truths of your word, God. And Lord, not only me, but touch your people this morning, those in this building and those that are listening online, God, this morning. Give them ears to hear, because I believe in this day that we're living, Lord, that you want to speak to your people. Let these words this morning be of encouraging. Let them edify. Let them build up. Let us be not dismayed, but let us be strong and courageous, because it is you, God, that goes with us. And everybody said amen and amen. God bless you as you're seated in the presence of the Lord. Amen. Well, excuse me this morning if I'm a little excited about being back in the house of the Lord. I feel like that from time to time, every time we've had to cancel and go into our COVID protocols, it seems that we lose that service and we're not able to obviously go back and do it. But that should make us appreciate even more what we do have. Anybody appreciate the Lord in his house this morning? Amen. Thank God for his presence this morning. Now, I want to preach this morning a little while, as the Lord will help me, on two words, being strong and being courageous. And here, if they'll go back again to verse 6 again, where the scriptures are telling us, I want to give us a little background, and then we're gonna go through the scriptures a bit. And I want to share with you something that I believe that God wants to communicate to the church today. In 2021, and all that we have been through, is that I believe that how many of you know there's a lot of fear out here? There's a lot of confusion in our midst. There's a lot of chaos in the streets, and there's so much going on. I'm afraid that even the church is not hearing the message of the Lord, that in the spite of everything that we have going on in America and in this world, we better not lose heart. We ought to be strong and courageous and not be dismayed, not be so unsettled, because we have a beautiful promise here that the Lord said, I'm going to go with you. I'm not going to forsake you. I'm not going to fail you in this hour. If I don't know about you, but I believe that it's an hour for God to shine like he's not shined in a long time. Come on and say amen. And if he's going to shine, he's going to shine through the church. So, Lord, I say to you, Lord, here I am. Here's my cup. Fill it up, Lord. Let me be the light in this earth that I need to be. Let our church be anointed. Let us be appointed for such a time as this. To be encouraged about what God is doing and not to be discouraged about what is going on in this world. And here we see that there is a changing of the guard for the children of Israel. Joshua is going to take over here. Moses is about to exit off the stage. And God has been with the children of Israel. And God has miraculously and providentially watched over the children of Israel all of these years. And God calls Moses and said, now you bring Joshua up in the sight of all of Israel, because I'm going to say some words over you that I need the people of Israel to hear. And this morning I want to say some words over this congregation that the people of God need to hear. Amen. And that is to not be dismayed and not to be discouraged, because our God, amen, is still working on our behalf. Amen. I feel the Holy Ghost in his house this morning. The word of the Lord here now, remember now, he brought them up. Moses is heading out. I can't be more plain than that, to know that the man of God is going over out of the scene here. And he says here, and I'm not going to go into all of 31. You read it when you get home. But he tells the people after he encourages Joshua. He said, now this people, they're going to lose heart. He said, these people are going to be rebellious. And these people, a lot of these people, when they get into the land flowing with the milk and honey, they're going to turn to other gods. That's what he warns them. He said, you've been a stiff-necked and rebellious people. While Moses said, well, I've been here. So I know when I leave, you're going to go the other way. Of course, not all of them, but a lot of them did. But what he's telling Joshua, amen, even though the tide of the world or the tide of the church may seem to be going in the opposite direction, amen. You be encouraged. You be lifted up. You be strengthened because I'm going to be with you just as I was with my servant Moses. I declare, I promise to you that I'm going to be with you. I don't know about you. I don't know how I would have got through 2020 without the Lord. Can I tell you, I didn't just get through 2020. It was about 50-some years ago when a beautiful baby boy was birthed into this world by his mama, amen. And from the moment I was conceived in my mother's womb, there's been one that's been right called right along beside me to walk with me, to talk with me, to guide me on my way. You know what? He's just a prayer away. Even before I can cry out, oh God, he's right there to answer, amen. Oh, I've been discouraged along the way, but I'm here to tell you, no matter what the devil brings, no matter what COVID brings, no matter what the government brings, no matter what the church, the rest of the church world wants to do for me and my house, we're going to serve the Lord because God has never let me down. He's never failed me, and he's never forsook me. Somebody help me and say amen. Moses is going out of the way here. Moses is telling Joshua, be strong now. Don't fear. Listen, I can understand the world acting crazy. I can understand, oh, there's so, y'all know there's so many internet rumors on what's going to happen the next few days, isn't there? There's so much stuff going on about this is going to happen and that's going to happen. And it's got people wringing their hands and worrying, amen. I don't know what's going to happen. I'm not a prognosticator. I'm not a prophet, if you will. But what I can tell you that whatever tomorrow brings, there's someone, amen, that's already in my tomorrow that has promised me whatever comes, whatever goes, he's going to hold my hand just like he was with Moses and just like he was with Joshua. He's going to be with you and he's going to be with me. Somebody say amen and praise the Lord in his house this morning. See, the church has become anxious during all of this. Come on here now. The church has become anxious and we forget whose side we're on. The church, what are we going to do? We're going to keep on being the church. They didn't say we weren't going to be affected by it. The children of Israel were affected by the things that they went through during the 40 years of traveling through the desert. But even when they got into the promised land, it was full of idolatry. It was full of giants. It was full of warring nations that hated them, that wanted to destroy them. When I look around and I see and I hear the voices in the culture and the voices in the world and those that in government and higher authority, in civil authorities, hear all of them condemning and attacking the church, amen. All I'm reminded, if God be for me, who can be against me? He said, I'm going to go with you. Gary, you preach. Church, you pray. Church of the living God, be the people that God called us to be, amen, because there is one who stands alone beside us. Glory, his name is Jesus. He's King of kings and Lord of lords. Somebody help me and say amen. See, we become fearful and we go by what we feel. We all do. We all go by feeling sometimes. That's what I say every time. I don't feel the Lord when I come to God's house. Sometimes I don't. Sometimes I have to. Why? I have to walk
by faith. That's all right, isn't it? We don't always feel like shouting the house down and running and praising God. And we don't, you know, I thank God we don't go by our feelings. But when we do go by our feelings, we can feel the fear. Oh, I go out in the highways and the byways, and the fear is tangible. You know, I would suggest we just shut the news off for a little while. Let me give you some good news, amen. God is still in control. God's got this, amen. God's not going to let his church go under. He said, upon this rock, I'll build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail, amen. I don't know about you that the church may come under attack in these next few years and days that we are facing, amen. We may see things, unprecedented attacks against the scripture, unprecedented attacks against the church, preaching of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Oh, but I'm reminded when I hear the words of Moses, to a Joshua, be strong and be courageous and be not dismayed, because just as I was with Moses, I'm going to be with you. Praise God this morning. Let's go to Joshua real quick, right quick. Joshua chapter 1, verses 5. The Bible said here now, Joshua is the man in charge now. Joshua's leading the children of Israel as they're getting ready to inherit and establish themselves in the land of Israel. He said, there shall not be any man be able to stand before thee all the days of thy life. That's coming from the Lord. Woo! Y'all didn't get that. Can't nobody, you know, one of my favorite stories was the three little pigs when I was growing up. It was. You can huff and you can puff, but you ain't never going to blow this house down. And I hear people declaring all what the devil's going to do and the government's going to do and all of this railing against those of us that believe and on the right side of the scripture. They're going to huff and they're going to puff, but we've got a word from the Lord this morning that there will not be anybody that will be able to stand before you as long as you're on the Lord's side. He said, as I was with Moses, so shall I be with you. And I will not fail thee, nor forsake thee. Verse 6, here we go again. God's telling this man, be strong and of good courage. For unto this people shalt thou divide for an inheritance the land, which I swear unto their fathers to give them. Verse 7, only be thou strong and very courageous. See, this doesn't sound like a church backing up. This doesn't sound like a church being cowered in a corner somewhere and say, y'all do what y'all need to do inside of those four walls, but just keep your opinions and all your preaching and all of your works and all of this stuff that you're talking about, amen. Just keep it over there in a corner. That don't what it sounds like to me, amen. I like where the Bible said everywhere that we put our foot down when he was talking to the children of Israel, that'll be your inheritance. I like it when Caleb said when he was 85 years old, he said, I've got a mountain, amen, that God said I could have, amen. Somebody said, oh man, it's full of giants. Caleb said, I'm just as strong as I was then as I am now, and they can't stand before me. Why? He won't go in his own power. He was going in the power of the blessed Holy Ghost of God. And a promise, amen, I'm here to tell you that as long as the church is on planet Earth, we've got a work to do, and there's nobody or nothing, no principality, power, rulers of darkness, spiritual weakness, no devil, no demon can stop the church of the living God. He said that thou mayest to do all, observe to do according to all the law which Moses my servant commanded. Listen to me, as long as we stay in the book, we got his backing. He said, which Moses my servant commanded. He said, turn not from it to the right hand or to the left, that thou mayest prosper wherever soever thou goest. See, here's what's going. Let's go to verse 9, and I'll try to keep moving on here. He said, the book of law, and verse 8, the book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth, but thou shalt meditate therein day and night, that thou mayest observe to do all according to that is written therein. For then thou shalt make thy way prosperous, and then thou shalt have good success. Praise God. Verse 9, have I not commanded thee? Be strong and of good courage. See, now, if I become a preacher that preaches half the word of God, this don't apply to me anymore. If I become a preacher and a pastor and a part of a church that doesn't stand on everything that God stands for, we can't hold to this promise. If I begin to preach the abominations that the world has said is okay, when I begin to define the sanctity of life and the sanctity of marriage or redefine it into something that God says that it's not, when I begin to define things that God says are an abomination, that it's okay, then I lose these promises. But can I tell you flat-footed this morning and let the church of the living God know that as long as we stay in the book, we observe the book, we meditate on the book, we believe the book, amen, God said, I'll go with you. That's a good place to clap your hands and praise the Lord. See, our foundational truth is God will not forsake his people. He will not fail us, and he will watch over his word to perform it. And I can tell you that when I said a while ago, when you go out in the highways and the byways of this world, and today there is fear everywhere. People are, men's hearts are failing them for fear. I just want to help you this morning because part of my job as pastor is to encourage the church, and according to Paul in Ephesians, is to equip the saints. That's you. That's the church. Amen. So what I'm trying to tell you is look at the word of God. Hear the man of God this morning. Be strong and be very courageous. Amen. And trust in the Lord God with all your heart. Stand on the word of God. Believe the word of God. If God said don't do it, then don't do it. If he says you can, then do it, but bless God, upon this rock I stand. All everything else is but sinking sand. Praise God this morning. Now, I don't, time will not allow me. It's been so many years. It's been a right good while since I've preached. Anybody ever heard of David and his Goliath? One of my favorite stories. One of my absolute favorite stories, my mother, as a young boy, my older brother, he's 10 and a half months older than I am, we would sit on the edge of our bed as my mama would read us Bible stories at night before we would go to bed. And I was enthralled by the story of this young man that God was going to use mightily. And the story of Goliath, David and Goliath, and many of us know that. But let me fast forward now from Moses and Joshua. And now Israel now is a young nation with in the promised land with the king Saul. And now they find themselves in 1 Samuel 17 and now they find themselves facing an ancient enemy. How many of you know we got an ancient enemy? Come on here. I'm not going to lift the devil up, but we're not going to act like he don't exist either. He's real, and I'm telling you, he's using this chaos and this fear that is in America today and in the world, and he's trying to shake the foundations of the church. Amen. That's what he's trying to do. He's got people cowered in fear, not knowing what to do, not knowing what direction to take. Amen. I'm all for using common sense. I'm all for using medical science. I'm all for all the advancements that are going on to help us get through this. But God, don't ever let me forget, amen, that no matter what I face, amen, I've got somebody that will always go with me. David here finds himself out tending the sheep, and his daddy called him and said, his daddy's name was Jesse, son, come, take these loaves of bread and take this to your brothers that are fighting this ancient enemy. There's a battle getting ready to go, and I want you to take this bread, and I want you to take this cheese to the captain of the thousand. The Bible lets us know that his brothers were serving him. Y'all bear with me just a minute. Everybody okay? Say amen. You ain't got to come back tonight. Y'all not to be in no hurry. So he said, David wasn't even planning on going, but his daddy sent him. And he said, take this stuff to your brothers on the front line and take this cheese to the captain of the thousand. David found his way heading over there to the front lines. Now, what you understand here, the ancient enemy of Israel, the Philistines or the Philistines, whatever way you want to pronounce it now, they have encamped themselves one on one mountain and one on another. Here are the Philistines and here are the children of Israel. And in the middle, there's a valley. And here we find ourselves now, a tremendous battle is about to take place. And David shows up. All of a sudden, he finds, instead of a group of mighty men of God that had these promises, anybody just remember the promises I read? God said, I'll go with you. No man will stand before you. Did y'all hear that? And here's David. He comes down there, and all of a sudden, see old Goliath, my buddy. The Bible said he was 6 cubits and a span. Cubits are about 18 inches. And then a span from here to here in a man's hand. But I'm going to tell you, some old Goliath was about 10 foot tall. Now, I'm 6'2¼, used to be anyway. But I can't imagine seeing a gigantic 10 foot warrior. And Goliath had a plan, y'all. Goliath, he says, you know what? Y'all are over here, and we're over here. And we're going to have a battle. But he said, I got an idea. Why don't I do this? Why don't you send out a champion from Israel, and I'll fight him, and we don't even have to fight as an army. He said, if your man kills me, we'll serve you. He said, but if I kill him, y'all serve us. And so he goes out every day. The Bible said every day for 40 days. He goes out down in that valley a little ways, and he starts blaspheming and mocking the armies of God. Every morning and every afternoon, 40 days, day after day after day. And so all of a sudden, David shows up, and here he is at the camp of the Israelites, and he says, who is this that blasphemes the God of Israel? Who is this that is mocking and doing all of this? And everybody said, it's Goliath of Gath, the champion. This 10-foot-tall, mighty warrior is challenging us, and there is not a single man. Listen to me. Hear me now. There's not a single man in Israel that will go out and fight him. All the battle-tested warriors that were there in the army of Israel, not a single one of them would go out and face Goliath. Come on here. You know why? The Bible, you read the whole chapter. The Bible said they were fearful and they were afraid. When we get out of the book and when we forget what God has said and we don't remember his promises, we forget how good that God is and what he is able to do. Come on and help me just a few more moments. Here we see now, and David said, well, bless God, if none of y'all won't fight him, I will. His brother, older brother, turned to him. He said, shut up, you're just being arrogant. I'm just paraphrasing this. And the Bible said that David heard him and turned away from him and went to another. Who is this guy? And finally they told him who it is. And King Saul, the Bible says, was head and shoulders above every other man in the land of Israel. Now, I don't know, history tells us that the average height of those men back then was probably a little over 5 foot, 5.5 foot. So maybe Saul was 6.5 foot. He was taller than anybody else in Israel. All of those men would look like a midget, if you will, in the sight of Goliath. So Saul hears about it, and he says, come here, David. He says, what's this I hear you talking about? He says, I'll go fight Goliath. David looked at him and said, you're just a youth. You're not battle tested. What can you do? Let me tell all our young people today. Youth don't have anything to do with it. You be strong and you be courageous. And you come on here, come on, old folks, say amen. You be young, you be strong and courageous, and you'll do great and mighty things for the kingdom of God. And Saul said, okay, well, you're too young. How do you think that you're going to beat Goliath? And David said, wait a minute. I got a testimony. See, most of our testimonies turn into bragging on the devil and what the devil has done. And, oh, the devil's on my trail and the devil's on my back and the devil did this. But David didn't do that. He said, Saul, you don't understand how I can know I can deliver this Philistine, amen. You know how I know that I can whoop him and beat him, amen, because I was tending my sheep one day and a bear run out of the woods. See, some of us need to testify about where God has brought us from, and maybe that'll help us to remember how good God really is and how strong and powerful God is. So God, David said, yeah, you don't understand, Saul, and I'm paraphrasing. You can read it later. He said, you know, when I was out tending the sheep and a bear come out of the woods and scooped one of my sheep up and run off with him, he said, I chased him down. I grabbed him by the beard. I took my sheep out of his mouth, and then I killed him with my bare hands. Woo! It gets even better than that, King Saul. Just a little while later, there come a lion out of the woods again. He grabbed a hold of one of my sheep, and I can just hear David now. I run over there and grabbed him by the mane, the symbol of his power. The devil is as a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. But let me tell you something right now. Greater is he that's within me than he that is in this world. He said, I grabbed that lion by his mane, snatched that sheep out of his mouth, and destroyed and killed that lion with my bare hands. And he says, as the Lord liveth today, just as that lion and bear was, so shall that uncircumcised Philistine be, amen. Saul said, well, go ahead on, big boy. But where you leave before you go, he said, I want you to take my sword and my armor. David said, well, okay. So he grabs that old big sword and that old armor, and I can just see him. You got to realize Saul was probably a foot and a half taller than David was. And he finally just took it off. He said, I can't use this. The Bible said, he said, I've not proved it yet. So the Bible said he went down to the stream and got him 5 smooth stones. He got him some rocks, amen. Come on, somebody, and say amen. What has a rock got to do with it, amen? I like it when the psalmist said in 62, he said, when I'm in trouble, I go to the rock that is higher than I, amen. I like what Jesus said upon this rock when he was talking about himself. He said, I'll build a church and the gates of hell shall not prevail. Can I tell you about another rock? It's called the chief cornerstone. Hallelujah. Let me tell you something. David took that rock and those 5 smooth stones, and he put one in his sling. And I've heard it preaching. You have too. He had 4 more in his package, in his little pouch there. And they said, well, what do you need 4 more? I understand throughout history and teaching of the commentaries that Goliath had 4 more brothers. Amen. Let me tell you something. God always makes provision. He knows where the enemy's going to come from. He knows how they're going to attack. And he knows how to give his people deliverance. Let me tell you something. 2020 was tough. 2021 might be rough. But we serve a God that is able to do exceeding and abundantly above all that we can ask or think. Woo, I wish I had about another hour. Y'all don't mean it. David said, y'all, I know everybody knows, like watching reruns. Y'all done seen, heard this story. I'm going to tell you, I'm going to encourage you. God wants his people to be strong and courageous. Not foolish about stuff. I don't mean that. Not irresponsible. Absolutely not. I can't emphasize that enough. I'm talking about, where is the trust of God at? David said, went out there, got them few stones, and Goliath sees him and says, what in the world? You send a dog out here to fight me. That's what he said. Called him a dog. That's the best you got. You're going to send that. He looked at Goliath looked at that little young fella and said, I'm going to kill you and feed you to the buzzards. He said, the fowl of the air, the Bible, the King James says, the fowl of the air and the wild beast of the field. Just let me tell it the way I do. Every time I ride by a road out here, there's a dead deer on the side of the road and there's 10 buzzards eating on him. Goliath said, David, you come on over here, son, and I'm going to kill you and feed you to the buzzards. David looked at that old boy and said, let me tell you what he told Goliath. He said, Goliath, he said, you come at me with a sword, a spear, and a shield,
But I come to you in the name of the Lord God of hosts. Come on here. The God of armies. He said, in this day, come on here. He said, this day, he said, I'm going to kill you and I'm going to feed you to the buzzards. Yes, that's what he did. Boy, I can, look, this man is 10 foot tall, probably mean as a rattlesnake. Come on here. Ain't no telling how many men Goliath had killed in his day. He was a warrior. He was a savage. He was a brute. He was a heathen. He was a devil-worshipping, idol-worshipping man. And he was probably enraged at the fact, who is this little bitty guy? And you're going to come at me and you're going to talk all of this. And the Bible said, you know, the Bible said that when Goliath made a move to him, David took off running to Goliath. Come on, be strong and courageous. He didn't back up from it. You know what? I get a lot out of, there's a whole lot more that I could preach on this, but I'm getting to the main point here. God gave him this faith, this belief that God could do anything through David. And David had this belief in him that, God, I'm going to do this for you. So he took off running toward a 10-foot giant. Y'all know the story. Young folk, I loved it when I was a boy. Still love it. Hadn't preached on it yet. Bible said, I don't know if he was right hand or left hand. I'm left handed. So he wound that thing up as he was running. I can just hear him say, you uncircumcised Philistine, you wicked, evil man, you've been blaspheming God and the armies of God. I got news for you. I got a message for you, son, from the Lord of hosts himself, from Jehovah God, amen, the all-sufficient, all-powerful one. And he let loose of that stone, and it's, the Bible said it sunk right in his forehead. Woo! Got to use whatever. God can use anything. Come on here. Use what God has given you, amen. I don't have much of a voice, but I like to sing. Don't preach that well, but I love to preach, amen. I wish I praised a little more than I do, but I'm going to praise. He made me a worshiper. He called me to be a child of God. And as long as I've got breath in my body, amen, I'm going to walk out and be strong and courageous and serve God with everything that is within me. Bible tells us, it sunk right in his forehead. And it fell over. Whom? David went back to the camp. Nope. Bible said David run up on him, took that sword out of his sheath. Can you imagine? The Bible talks a little bit about his armor, about Goliath's armor. There's no telling how much it weighed. There's no telling how big that sword was. He takes that sword out. I know we got kids here, but this is in the Bible, so we got to tell it the way it is. He takes that sword out, and he cuts David's head off. Okay, big boy, who you gonna feed to the buzzards now? Come on here. I'm telling you right now, we are facing, as a church, we're facing the giants of fear. We're facing the giants of the government trying to come against us. We're facing the scorn and the ridicule of a lost and dying world that don't know no better. Come on here now. We're facing confusion and chaos on every hand. We're facing a giant of immorality. Come on here in America. We're facing the giant of anti-God, anti-Christ spirit that is permeating the world. But let me tell you something. The people of God, be strong and of good courage, amen, because the battle is not yours. It is of the Lord, amen. Come on, somebody. Stand still and see the salvation of the Lord. And cut his head off. I like, come on, singers and musicians. I like what David said. I'll close with this. I got so much more. I like what David said. Before he did that, he told Goliath, he said, God's going to deliver you in my hand. And I'm going to kill you. And I'm going to feed your body to the buzzards. That's what he said. Now, you ready for this next thing? He said, so that everybody will know there's a God in Israel. Y'all, they didn't get that, Brother Lloyd. We're going to come through this thing. The church, the true church, I don't know about the playing church, but the true church is going to come through this. And this America, this world, this antichrist spirit, this anti-God sentiment that's running through the thread of all that is against the church, they're going to know that there's a God in heaven. They're going to know that there's a God of the church. That's what they're going to know. Would you stand to your feet? I want you to bow your heads this morning. I know we're going to have an altar call, and we as we go through all of our protocols. If you want to stay where you are, you can stay. If you want to come to this altar and you need prayer, we'll pray. I want to say to this congregation, I want you to bow your head. Let's reverence the Lord here. God wants to encourage us this morning. God wants to show Himself mighty this morning. I don't know if you're fearful. I don't know if you're afraid of what's going to... God just sent me by this morning to encourage the people of God. The battle's not, it's not ours. We're soldiers. Yeah, we got to stand. This battle belongs to the Lord. And just like God put 5 stones in David's hands, God's put something in your heart, your mind, and your spirit. There's so much uncertainty, so much fear, so much going on out in this world, the fear of the unknown. What's this next administration going to bring? What's this next Congress going to enact? What's the governor going to do? How's the church going to be affected? I can tell you, as God spoke to Moses, as God spoke to Joshua, as God spoke to David, let the God of Israel speak to us today. No weapon formed against us will prosper. The Bible declares, the prophet Isaiah declared that when the enemy comes in like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord will lift up a standard against him. I believe, and I'm not just, this is not a hype, this is not just boosting words. I believe the church has one of the greatest opportunities it's ever been presented with to rise up and show the world that there's a God in heaven. This morning, if you need God to encourage you, if you just want to come and spend a moment in a few minutes or moments in prayer, I want all that can and would. I want you to come and start filling these altars up. And if you're more comfortable praying where you are, you stay right where you are. Come on, church, those that want to pray. Come on. Let's have an altar call. Come on. That's what this altar is for. Make you an altar at your seat. Come on, let's spend a few moments with the Lord this morning. Dear God, if you need prayer this morning for your body, we'll pray for you. Come on, if you're going to stay at your seat, I want you to start praying. God, give you the boldness of a David. Give you a boldness of an Elijah. Give you the boldness of an Elisha. Give you the boldness of the Apostle Paul. Give you a boldness of the prophet Nathan as he had to correct David with the matter of Bathsheba. Come on, worship the Lord where you are this morning. Worship the Lord. Spend some time with God. Oh, God, this morning. Oh, God. Oh, God. God, send a revival, Lord, an awakening to us, God. Encourage us, God. Encourage us this morning. Let us be like David when they took his wife and his children, all that he had. And his men said, let's kill David.